welcome to NewsClick. Last week, an American court blocked Argentina from meeting its international debt payments if it did not first repay a group of hedge fund investors to whom it supposedly owes money. Despite Argentina having actually made its payments into a trustee bank, these funds cannot be disbursed to its creditors unless it first clears its default with these hedge funds. Now, Argentina has failed in its appeal to the United States Supreme Court, but has apparently moved to the International Court of Justice. Though whether the US agrees to accept the jurisdiction of the ICJ is another matter entirely. Now, to discuss this rather strange situation and what it means for Argentina and the international financial order, we have with us Professor of Economics at JNU, Jyoti Ghosh. Thanks, Jyoti, for joining us
today. It's a pleasure.
Now, could you briefly take us through the background to the developments over the last few weeks? I mean, why does Argentina owe these hedge funds money in the first place? And if they do, why don't they just pay them back?
Well, let's go back to how Argentina got into this situation. If you remember, Argentina in the 1990s had a system whereby they pegged their currency to the dollar and they had a very rigid system of exchange rate and so on. In that period, they contracted a very large external debt. Now, ultimately, it turned out that this was an unsustainable situation, and in 2001, they had to break that link with the dollar, and they had a massive depreciation of their currency and they went into a financial crisis. Now, after that financial crisis, in this period of instability where it was an effective default because they simply could not repay their debt, several things happened. One of them was that the IMF, which stepped in as usual, wanted all the debts to be repaid on the basis of the old exchange rate for the foreign creditors.
Right.
But the domestic creditors were supposed to be repaid on the new exchange rate, which really meant that it was 30% of the previous value.
Right.
This also made it a debt that it was impossible for Argentina to repay. In 2004 and 2005, the government of Nestor Kirchner managed to renegotiate the debt with something like 80% of the creditors. So they came to a deal whereby they said that, look, the actual value of this debt, as you know, is now something like 20%. The market, the secondary market, is trading it at 20% of the previous value. So will you accept that value? And we promise that we will repay you everything on this new and more sensible value. Now, let's also be clear that when people talk about the value of a debt, anything that is unpaid gets added to the principal and compounded. So maybe you've originally borrowed only, say, 10 billion. But when you delay the payment, that interest gets accumulated onto the principal, so the value of your debt expands to, let's say, 30 billion. Many of the creditors actually recognize this. Their original loan was much, much less than the current value of the debt. And of course, the value of the debt in the secondary market was much less also. So they accepted it. 80%, as I said, of the creditors, including many of the major American banks, accepted this. A few creditors held out. They refused to accept it. Anyway, then this was done and Argentina proceeded. Now, obviously, those who held out were not getting repaid anything. Then what happened was that these holdout creditors, as they're called, most of them sold their debt to what are known as vulture funds. Vulture funds are hedge funds that are specifically set up to buy distressed debt and then do whatever it takes to somehow get it. Okay. And so that's what they do. In other words, they are not just normal hedge funds. Their job is to collect all this distressed debt at maybe one-tenth the value. In fact, it's estimated that they did. Most of these vulture funds bought this debt at one-tenth of the face value. Okay? And then they try and use legal means and various other means to pursue and get full repayment. Some of the hedge funds, like Singer and Company, have actually been successful in other cases, with Ghana, with a number of other cases. And they use all kinds of means to prevent Argentina from being able to repay others until they first repay the vulture funds. Now, what happened in Argentina in this specific case...
But just to sort of interrupt you, why do they expect preferential payment in these cases?
Not preferential. What they're saying is that we never agreed to this debt renegotiation, but you owe us money, so pay it back. So they are going by the original debt,
right,
if you like, you know, not a renegotiated debt. They're saying, we don't accept any renegotiation. So you cannot pay us the lower value that you are paying all these other people. You have to pay us the full amount. Normally, in fact, in whenever there are debt workouts, the US law, for example, when there's a debt workout, if 70% of the creditors have agreed to something, the other 30% are forced to go along with it. But this, there is no international mechanism for a debt workout. There's no internationally agreed mechanism for a sovereign debt workout. What happened in Argentina's case is that two hedge funds went to a New York court demanding that they be repaid in full, and also saying that unless Argentina pays them, they cannot pay any other creditor. Now, this revolves around a peculiar clause. It's called pari passu, or equal treatment terms, okay? And it's a peculiar legal outcome because it's basically saying that we have to be treated on par with all other creditors, where in fact they're not being. They're demanding, as you say, effectively preferential treatment because of full payment. Judge Grisa, Thomas Grisa, in the district court in New York, actually went along with this and said, yes, they have a right and they must be paid in full. And only then can Argentina repay the other creditors.
So the court went on a purely contractual understanding?
Not just contractual. It is a very unusual interpretation of the pari passu clause. In fact, it is unprecedented. It's novel, it's unprecedented, and it's the first time it has ever been interpreted in this way.
Okay, so now how can an American court, however, have jurisdiction over the Argentinian state?
The trouble is,
Argentina just ignore this?
Well, Argentina could ignore it if it wanted to say the hell with you to all its creditors, but it doesn't. It wants to repay the creditors with whom it has renegotiated. It is in all good faith saying, we negotiated with you, we've promised you something, we are going to repay it. However, because all this debt was contracted in New York or in the United States, basically with Wall Street, it is subject in the United States to US law. Mm-hmm. Argentina can ignore it elsewhere. Mm-hmm. But what Judge Grisa has done is something even more remarkable. Judge Grisa has said anybody who assists Argentina in repaying this debt to its other creditors is also in contravention of the law, which is another extraordinary judgment, which is unprecedented. So what it said is that if some other bank facilitates Argentina repaying the other creditors, they are also illegal.
Yep.
It has prevented, that's really what has, yes. So when people say Argentina's in default, that's false. Argentina wants to pay the creditors.
They're
it's not being
able
allowed to pay the creditors.
Now, what does this default actually mean for Argentina in terms of its domestic economy as well as its international commitments?
You know, right now, you see, I'll tell you, the reason why they were anxious to get this is because Argentina has been excluded from global credit markets now, ever since then.
So
about 10 years. So they would like to get back into borrowing from the international markets. It does make a difference to Argentina because it really means that they cannot run a current account deficit. They cannot finance it through borrowing at any point. They have managed so far. They have managed to run current account surpluses or just been in balance or managed to raise enough money to actually generate, you know, what they need. So, but it is difficult. It does mean that occasionally they have to have import controls. Occasionally they have to put balance of payments restrictions. It means that they have concerns about domestic inflation. There are reasons why Argentina would like to be free of this and is making all the efforts required. However, because of this ridiculous interpretation of the pari passu clause and the further requirement that nobody else can be repaid even by third parties, it is unable to do so. Now, what people don't understand is that the implications for Argentina are much less than the implications for the global financial system. And I think that's why it is so ridiculous to see how Wall Street is not being more aggressive in trying to stop this kind of, shall we say, court action.
Mm-hmm.
The US administration, actually, the Obama administration came out and said it was concerned about this. The IMF has said it's concerned about this. And pretty much everybody in Europe is concerned about this. Because what this means is that it actually threatens any international lending.
Mm-hmm.
Let me explain why. You see, any lending contains a possibility that finally
of default,
right? And that has to be somehow inbuilt into the system. One way it's inbuilt is in the credit rate, in the interest rate itself.
Right.
You know, the spread of a...
Yeah.
And anyone who is lending to a more risky client
will
is charging a higher rate. So One point is that already people who were lending to Argentina had already factored in a possibility of default, and they had already got a higher interest rate on the basis of that possibility, number one. So we can't say that you have to be paid back in full, then you cannot be demanding a higher interest rate in the earlier phases, okay? The second is that every credit system, national, subnational, international, requires this possibility of default to somehow be incorporated in the system. The United States has many bankruptcy laws, Chapter 9, Chapter 10, Chapter 11, dealing with companies, municipalities, individuals, because they recognize that there will always be a possibility of default, bankruptcy, and you have to have what is called an orderly workout of this debt. Many international debt contracts now include what are called collective action clauses, which are precisely this, somehow making an orderly debt workout. Mm-hmm. So that collective action means 70% of your creditors agree on something, well, the 30% have to lump it, have to go along, okay? The Eurozone debt, for example, none of the Eurozone debt renegotiations would have been possible without this. But basically, you can't have a properly functioning sovereign debt
world
system
economy
without this. Certainly, an international financial system in which sovereigns can borrow cannot function without some debt workout mechanism. If every time you have to say, no, there's no such thing as even a partial default.
So has this incident now led to, I mean, renewed calls for
yes.
such a financial system?
There are indeed renewed calls for this. I'm surprised that they are not louder. I think at the moment, when it first happened, there was, in fact, well, UNCTAD came out with a very important piece. They have been, in fact, always arguing for a sovereign debt restructuring mechanism. But a number of other people actually demanded it, as I said, even the IMF demanded that we now have to think about a way of ensuring that there's an orderly debt workout mechanism internationally. Since then, things have quietened down. Why? Because I think it's a fool's paradise. People believe that this will be a localized problem in Argentina. We can manage it for now, so let's just muddle along as we have.
Not put a system in place.
Exactly. I think that that's a seriously over-optimistic position.
So what about this particular incident? Where does Argentina go from here, given that I'm pretty sure America is not going to accept ICJ jurisdiction over the matter?
Yes.
So what happens now? They just have to make those payments, otherwise...
Well, what it can do is try and do other ways of making the payments. Mm-hmm. It's very interesting that China is playing a more active role. China has actually offered to a kind of currency swap arrangement, which would dramatically ease its foreign exchange constraint for Argentina at the moment. There have been suggestions that what China should do is just buy up all the sovereign debt. Mm-hmm. Which it can easily do without even noticing. And that resolves the problem from the point of view of Argentina, if it buys this debt in the secondary market.